A compulsive hoarder faces up to her condition and a house full of stuff in an hour. Obsessed is new at one after we cash in on the luck of the Irish with a brand new look at Louis Walsh.
Louis Walsh is one of the most famous and successful managers in pop music today. He's also the mastermind behind some of the country's best-loved pop acts. As a judge on The X Factor, he courts controversy on a weekly basis, constantly sparring with his arch rival, Simon Cowell.
I think they've got great voices, but this song, it was a lazy, lazy choice, Simon. I don't know why.
Along the way, Boyzone, Ronan Keating and Westlife have all basked in the glow of his Midas touch. And with a staggering 28 number one hits under his belt, he's now regarded as one of the most powerful pop managers in the world. But what really makes him tick? This one-hour special reveals the rise and rise of Louis Walsh, with intimate access to some of the celebrity world's biggest names.
He gets me to a point and I'm like, I'll look for something to throw, and then it's always the water, and it's like, well, you can have it then.
Simon Cowell reveals what really happened when Louis was sacked from The X Factor.
I mean, he called me every name under the sun. I mean, just unloaded.
How he threatened to walk away from one of the biggest bands in pop chart history.
He was so serious about leaving that night, and there was, and I remember I started crying, like I started bawling crying like a child, like, and I couldn't help it, because I thought that was it, my dreams are, that was it, it was gone.
The true story behind the split between Louis and his famous protege, Ronan Keating.
It wasn't about money, it wasn't about contracts or anything like that. It was just, we had, I guess we'd grown apart. That was it.
And how, after masterminding Boyzone's comeback, he coped with the tragic news of Stephen Gately's death.
I don't think the boys are ever going to get over it, because it's not going to be the same looking at that stage with a massive, massive space. Nobody's ever going to fill his shoes.
The X Factor is a global phenomenon, spanning 21 countries across several continents. It's quite simply one of the biggest success stories in television history.
I'm Edward.
I'm John, and we're 17, and we're from Dublin. All the way.
Hello, Dublin.
See for you guys.
Where do you see yourselves in 15 years from now?
Well, I see myself being older.
Today, Louis splits his time between London, Dublin, and Los Angeles. We caught up with him at one of his favorite hotels, the Dillon in Dublin.
I'm from a family, there's nine children in our family, and there's seven boys, two girls. I'm second oldest. And just a very normal, I suppose, a poor Catholic Irish family. I'm glad I'm from the west of Ireland. I'm glad I grew up there. I've really good memories growing up. Every week, I used to save up, and I used to buy 145. It was like a single record. And that was my big thing every week, to buy a record. And I used to watch Top of the Pops on the Thursday, buy the records on the Friday or Saturday. And that was my big thing.
In 1969, Louis left the cosiness of County Mayo behind and joined one of Ireland's top music promoters, Tommy Hayden. For Louis, it was the start of the Yellow Brick Road.
So I got to Dublin from the west of Ireland, and I'm working for Tommy Hayden, and he managed a lot of the big show bands then. Nobody would know them in the UK, but bands like Red Hurley and the Royal Show Band with Connie Lynch. So I was working in their office. I was just the office boy. But you know, that was the best, best learning curve that anybody can get. You start at the bottom and you kind of claw your way there to the top.
In 1979, Louis had a chance meeting that was to change his life forever.
I met a guy called Johnny Logan, and I started to manage him. And we were offered this song called What's Another Year. We put the song in for Ireland, and Johnny Logan won the Eurovision in The Hague in 1980, and that was it.
I've been waiting such a long time, looking out for you, but you're not here. What's another year?
I got a taste of international success because I went to Top of the Pops with him. He had a number one record in the UK. He had a number one record in like 10 different countries all around Europe. And I used to go everywhere with him. So now I realized there's a big world outside Ireland. It's not just about show bands and ballrooms. It's about selling records. And he was a massive star all around Europe overnight.
What's another year?
Hogan went on to win the Eurovision for a second time with Hold Me Now in 1987. They followed it with an unprecedented third win in 1992 with Why Me, performed by Linda Martin.
I'm in Ireland, I've had all the Eurovision hits, and I go to The Point in Dublin to see a band called Take That. And I was expecting just, you know, good show, English pop band, and I was absolutely blown away because they put on a show.
Louis used to call me over and over and over and over again before I knew him. I had no idea who he was. But about three or four times a week, my PA would say, this guy from Ireland's on the phone, Louis Walsh, would you talk to him? No. I didn't know who he was, but he was the most persistent person I'd ever met in my life.
And I thought, God, I'd love to do an Irish version of Take That.
I met Louis 1993, October, I think it was, for the Boys On auditions, the Ormond Quay in Dublin. 300 lads singing and dancing, basically, to try and get into this band.
I remember Ronan distinctly walking in, and I remember Stephen. And Stephen used to call me every single day, Stephen Gary. He said, what height do you have to be? What do I have to do? He was so keen. And he sent me in. He was the only person with the whole audition to send me, like, a proper CV and photographs and everything. They had that very, very famous Late Late Show appearance.
These lads, and they are going to be, or four of them are going to be, Ireland's answer to Take That.
Forgetting they'd never been to a TV studio. They hadn't sung together and they'd never danced together.
Louis was the laughing stock of this country when he went on, put Boys on the Late Late Show, which is like the kind of the Parkinson of the time. Like, no one believed that this band would ever work.
Nobody, basically, in the country could get a band like Boys On with no record deal, no song, nothing, no plot on the Late Late Show the day before, organised like that. That's the way Louis worked, you know, he could pull those strings.
The thing about that clip is, this proves, you know, if you believe in yourself and you work hard enough, anything is possible. Boyzone is living proof.
We all do laugh at it, you know, we do like it. As much as we give out about it, it is fun. It's good crack. Yeah, I mean, I have an excuse why I made an idiot of myself on the Late Late Show in front of millions, because I was only 16 years of age. I was only a baby. And, it was, you know, that's 16 years ago. Half my life I've been doing this now. I mean, it's mad. Louis always said and always thought, like, you know, any press is good press. People were talking about us the next day, but I remember myself going down, working in Corky's shoe shop the next day and walking down the street thinking I was the bee's knees, thought I was super. Hey, did you see me last night? Hey, did you see me last night? I was on the Late Late Show. What an idiot, what a plonker.
Amazingly, that performance in 1993 launched Boyzone onto the international stage.